Good morning. The back end of 1978, the last few days of 1978 were very stormy, very wild, very wet. I was on the North Cornish coast with my family on a holiday. It was so wild and so stormy that even the herring gulls and the few lesser black-backed gulls were hunkering down into the beach, looking almost legless to try and avoid the storm. The sea was, you know, seething and surging. The spray was spitting and snapping on our faces as we walked across the beach. You may be thinking, well, okay, that's great. You sort of painted a little thing which happened about 44 years ago. What's the relevance about that? Well, it's incredibly relevant, massively relevant. It was, for me, one of those magic moments in life. I was falling in love with the most amazing and most wonderful woman. And she still is the most amazing and most wonderful woman. And I decided to send Vicky a postcard, and on it I wrote just seven letters. Je t'aime. A few days later, and I'm still on that frayed Atlantic edge of the North Cornish coast, and I receive a postcard in return with just 12 letters written on it. Je t'aime aussi. Now, of course, I read and reread and reread and reread that letter, that postcard. And that's what you do with love letters, isn't it? You read and reread. You read backwards. You read upside down. You imagine what was being written down and try and imagine the person as she, in my case, wrote down what she was writing. Because it may sound quaint and old-fashioned nowadays. I suspect nowadays it'd be a video on a continual loop. Tick-tock, 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 tick. Oh no, the battery's gone! This is a love letter. A love letter from God to you and I. A love letter to God, because after the fall, it was necessary for God to reach out and communicate to us. It's a love letter that begins with a creation. Then goes on to the fall, the call of Abraham, the covenant with Abraham, story of Joseph. It goes into talking about call of Moses. It talks about the amazing power encounter between the kingdom of Yahweh and the kingdom of darkness. The giving of the law, the Ten Commandments, and into the wilderness as they're walking through to the promised land. And then they rebel. But then you have in Leviticus, the third book of the Bible, the teaching of the law. And all that sacrifice and the challenges that come about because God has chosen a people to be his own. And because he's a holy God, how do a sinful people live in the presence of a holy God? Hence all the sacrifices. And then, of course, that generation dies in the wilderness. And so there's a generation born in the wilderness who did not hear or know about the heritage, about the giving of the law on Mount Sinai. And so Moses, in three amazing sermons in Deuteronomy, gives a preaching of the law to the people who are about to go into the promised land. I wish I could carry on further, but I've got other things to say this morning. It's a love letter. It's a love letter from God to you and I that deserves, needs to be read and reread. In John chapter 5, verse 39, this is what Jesus said. The scriptures bear witness about me. John 5, verse 39, the scriptures bear witness about me. You see, this is a love letter, but it's Jesus' autobiography. The 39 books of the Old Testament and 27 books of the New Testament are, those 66 books are like 66 mirrors to show us the brilliance, the majesty, the excellence of God's Son, Jesus. They're like 63 lenses that give us an opportunity to focus down on the plan of God for our salvation. And it's been given, this love letter, this written word has been given to lead us to the living word, to Jesus. The only solution to our guilt before God does not come from general revelation, having some knowledge of God in our hearts, in our minds, in our spirits, but only through special revelation, through the forgiveness of sins, through Jesus' death on the cross. And because the Bible is God's written revelation of who he is and what he's done in history, in redemptive history. And God's glorious self-revelation finds its full expression in Jesus. You know, he's the ultimate revelation of Jesus. The writer of the Hebrews says in those first four amazing verses of chapter 1 of Hebrews, he talks about being the radiance of God's glory and the exact imprint of his being. Charles Wesley, of those four verses at the beginning of Hebrews, talked about how the incarnate God, the incarnate Son Jesus, is God's majesty contracted to a span, the span that is a baby. And what was Jesus' view of Scripture? Well, when we read Jesus' view, if we can have the passage up for the readings, can we have the Matthew one, please? Do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. You see, Jesus assumed that the Old Testament was the authoritative word of his Father. And it's not uncommon when we see Jesus discussing and arguing, as it were, with the Pharisees and religious leaders of the day, that he's arguing on the basis that the Old Testament is true. It's true. And he saw his life, his entire life, as a fulfillment of Scripture. So he used it, for example, in Matthew 4, we read, to resist temptation. He used it to settle disputes. At the end of his life, he actually died quoting Scripture. My God, why have you forsaken me? Psalm 22. And on the very resurrection day, on his very resurrection day, he starts to explain Scripture at length to those two disciples on that Emmaus road. So the Bible, the love letter to you and I, it's a story by which we are to live our lives today. And how do we live our lives today? Is it, for example, the story by which we live our lives, or is there another story that we have through which we live our lives? Those two postcards, Je t'aime and Je t'aime aussi, were love letters to be read and reread and reread. And the Bible is a love letter from God, but it is so much more than that. So in Deuteronomy 32, that's amazing. Those last few chapters in Deuteronomy are incredible. But in chapter 32, we read these words. It is chapter 32, verse 47. For it is no empty word for you, but your very life. It is no empty word for you, but your very life. The Bible gives life to us. It is life-giving. It's life-sustaining. It's life-equipping. It is wisdom. It is truth. You know, the crowning of the monarch, the coronation service, the moderator of the Church of Scotland hands the new monarch a Bible. And in some words that he says to her, "This is wisdom." I'm using the word her because I'm referring back to Queen Elizabeth's coronation. This is wisdom. This is wisdom. And we need to listen to the truth revealed to us in the Bible, and we need to live by the truth revealed to us in the Bible. So let's have now the second reading, the 2 Timothy 3 reading, please. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. I suspect it may be a familiar passage here, but Paul, in the context of this verse, is encouraging Timothy to persevere in the faith that he was taught by his grandmother Lois and his mother Eunice. And he has been acquainted with the scriptures. In the text, it talks about sacred writings since his youth. And Paul's reminding Timothy, that only these scriptures carry the message of salvation concerning Jesus Christ crucified and risen. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. So the word scripture there, it's in the Greek, it's graphe, where we have that English word paragraph. That's where that comes in there. Graphe means basically a writing. And so it's referring to writing. And in the context of the New Testament, it's the Old Testament that is being referred to, the 39 books of the Old Testament. And Paul says all writing from the Old Testament, all meaning every bit. There's not one part that's not part of this, which has been breathed out by God. It's not pick and mix.
I once read the story of a preacher who, wanting to really make the point that we do not have the freedom to pick and choose from scriptures. I mean, I've got a loose leaf Bible that helps when I have to throw things out if I don't like them. But this particular Bible got out the front of the church and opened up his Bible and started to tear it up. I don't like that bit. And scattered all bits of Bible in front of him. It was quite shocking. But the point was made. We are not free to choose what we want or not want. Scripture, we're told, Paul says, is breathed out by God. God breathes it out. God speaks it out. You know, when the Bible speaks, God speaks. And all of the scriptures, all of the Bible, have this incredible characteristic of God-breathedness. God-breathedness. They're God's words. Profitable, we see, or useful, it says in this translation. Beneficial, advantageous. Yeah, it's good for us because it is the Word of God. It is good for us because it is the Word of God. If I can be as bold to rephrase that bit of the verse, I could say this: all Scripture is God-breathed and therefore is good for you. And there are our two challenges: God-breathed and useful, God-breathed and profitable. Because, you know, do we have confidence, for example, that the Word of God, that Scripture is indeed the Word of God? Or are we convinced that God's Word is good for us? You know, we live in a society, a world where lots of things are, the narratives and stories and all things going about, and again we'll be told that actually it's not good for us, it's all the various things you want to throw at it, and it's not the Word of God, it's still being changed and all that stuff like that. And Paul talks about four tasks. He talks about teaching. You know, the Bible shows us the truth and the right way to live. The Bible tells us what to believe. It tells us what sound doctrine is. It talks about reproof, where the Bible tells us when we go wrong and challenges our errors. Paul tells us what not to do and what not to believe. It enlightens us, which is unsound doctrine. Thirdly, the Bible corrects us. It's how we can get back on track, how we can put things right again in our lives, our thinking and our actions. The Bible sets our conduct right, telling us what not to do. And fourthly, the Bible tells us and shows us the pathways of living. I, I love making connections in the Bible. And I think there's an extraordinary connection between Deuteronomy, the fifth book of the Old Testament, and Paul's letter to the Philippians. Now, how do I make this connection? Well, it's amazing, really. See, at the end of the day, that generation born in the wilderness had to hear the law. And so Moses preached these three sermons to the people born in the wilderness. And he was preaching this sermon to them, so that when they went into the promised land, their conduct would commend the living God. They knew what they had to believe, but their conduct would commend the living God to the surrounding nations. Paul, writing to the church in Philippi, it's a church being persecuted massively, because in about the mid-40s BC, it was made a Roman colony, which made everyone born there and who lives there to worship the emperor as the living God. And here's the people in that city, that town, refusing to bow their knees to the emperor, to Caesar, to worship. And Paul, paradoxically, is a prisoner of that very same person in Rome. And what Paul is saying is that your conduct should always commend Christ. Your conduct should always commend Christ. And so what the Bible is about right doctrine and right living, right belief and right behavior. And so does the Bible inform our beliefs, and does it influence our behavior? I mean, let's stop and think and ask ourselves that question. You know, does this Bible inform my thinking? Does this Bible influence my behavior? In a world fueled by narcissism and the tick culture, we need to say to ourselves, what is it actually saying? And how does it influence my thinking, my beliefs, and my behavior, my actions? Our calling as individuals and as a church is to make a difference on earth for heaven's sake. And we do so through our conduct commending Christ, through our longing for and living in the presence of God. And we do so through our beliefs and our behaviors commending Christ to a needy world. And what we believe and how we behave should always commend Christ. And it should be at the very heart of our lives. You see, there's nothing that God calls anyone to do that he does not equip them through scriptures for life, for godliness, for fruitfulness. So in this verse, Paul tells us very straightforwardly what's right, what's not right, how to get right, and how to stay right. Is the Bible at the heart of the story of your life? Is God's story of salvation, you know, at the very center of your life? Or perhaps it's now at the circumference, or perhaps even beyond. Is there another story, perhaps, that you lead your life by? Now, I know, because I've been in this place many times, that the idea of reading a Bible can be challenging. It can be very difficult. And what I've realized is that over the years, and since I've got that privilege, that curated snippets of the Bible can only ever lead to boredom and indifference in my life. And therefore, it's important to really sort of find something that helps me to read the Bible. But if we follow a Bible reading plan, we start on January the 1st with all the enthusiasm we can muster. We get as far as sort of February and March time, we're in the sacrifices of Leviticus, and we're struggling a bit by then. And then we go on a bit further, we end up in Chronicles, and we've got all those names. I mean, goodness gracious me, how many names do we have to read to go through this bit? And then actually you may be successful and get right through to Revelation at the end of the year, and then you think, what on earth was that all about? Well, that's the point, of course, because it's written to Christians who are being persecuted on earth, to give them hope. Now, one of the Bibles that I was recommended when I was a younger Christian to read, was this, called the this is the Murray McShane, Robert Murray McShane's Bible reading plan. It's just a load of readings and letters. This is only a small version, and it could be bigger as well, but you can download these things. And the thing about reading plans is this, with this Murray, this McShane reading plan, you read the Old Testament once a year, and you read the New Testament and Psalms twice a year. Now, the problem we've got, of course, is this. We get so riddled with guilt and frustration because we get behind on the schedule. We give up on the sacrifices. The names are just too much for us. And so what I want to do to you, I want to say tonight, is just this today, is to actually find something that actually works for you. Works for you. Now, what I use is this. This is a Navigator Bible reading plan. Again, this is downloadable. It's free. The thing about the Navigator reading plan is you have 12 months, 1 to 12 months. So it can start at any time you like. You can start today if you want. And it only has readings for 1 to 25 days of each month. Now, isn't that amazing? Because it recognizes actually that we do get behind. And so we've got 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, and 31 to catch up or to do something else. So I think I want to encourage us to try that going forward. I'm drawing to a close now. I'm conscious that we could go on. I did say to Mike that I was going to talk from Genesis 1, verse 1, right through to Revelation, the last verse. But I think I would have been driven out or forced out of this place, and you would have all gone to sleep. There is a prayer. Every Sunday, the Church of England has a collect, which is a prayer that is part of the liturgy of the Church of England. It's a prayer that actually is a petition. It's a prayer that actually can be used amazingly as a sort of devotional aid in Bible reading. Well, on the second Sunday of Advent, which is normally about the 6th, 7th of December, there's this collect, which is referred to colloquially as Bible Sunday. And this is a collect. It says, "Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant us that we may in such way hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that by patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you've given us in our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen." Thomas Cranmer wrote this prayer in 1549. This prayer was written at the heart of the English Reformation, when they were rediscovering the Bible. When I went to theological college, in the front entrance hall of the theological college was a table and a chair upon which William Tyndale wrote his translation of the Bible, for which he was assassinated on the orders of Henry VIII in Belgium. And he wrote this prayer because he was concerned that the practice of reading the Bible had become altered, broken, and neglected. I'm speaking to myself today that it is so easy to neglect this amazing love letter. It's so easy to alter it and to change it. But it is so amazing. It is so powerful. And so I want to, with Cranmer, invite you and invite myself to love the Bible, to learn it, to learn from it, not for its own sake, but for our own patience and comfort. So I'm going to close now with just a couple of questions for us to apply into our lives. Are the purposes for which God gave his word, the Bible, being fulfilled in your life? Does the Bible inform your beliefs and influence your behavior? If not, why not? Do you allow other thinking and other ideas to inform and shape the way you live, leaving the Bible for those sort of God moments on one day a week or whenever? Because my prayer for myself every day, and my prayer for all of us here this morning, is, dear, dear God, you've given us this amazing love letter that shows us in all his glory, the beauty, the brilliance, the excellence, the majesty of Jesus, that sees the, we can focus down on the amazing plan of salvation that you've given us. And dear God, please help me today to know what is right, to know what is not right, and then how to stay right, and how to get right, and how to stay right. Dear God, I need it each and every day. Thank you, God. Thank you.